Shana Tova.
Shana Tova.
Hi, everyone. Boker Tov. All right. We welcome to everyone that is not at 8831. Welcome to everyone that is at 8831. We are here to start or continue our celebration. We had a wonderful day yesterday, full of lots of heartfelt drashes, full of very soul-filled songs and liturgy, and full of lots of wisdom, of Torah wisdom. And I expect much of the same today. We're also going to do a little learning. I want to start by giving an attention, but also giving us a little bit of heads up of how today is both similar and a little bit different. So Rosh Hashanah is celebrated almost worldwide as a two-day festival. And so this is a continuation. It's actually considered one long day from the traditional standpoint. And so we bring the same amount of spirit, we bring the same amount of wisdom, and we bring the same amount of openness that we enter the holiday with. So, but it's going to be a little different. So the way that we laid out today, we're going to have a little bit of a morning service. Morning services always start with gratitude. So we're going to start with some gratitude. We're going to start with some songs to open us up. And remind us what we're grateful for. And then we're going to do a little learning. And we're going to have a variety of rabbis. So we're going to get a number of different perspectives, both for folks that are on Zoom and for folks that are joining us here in the sanctuary. And then we're going to jump back into a Torah service. And the Torah service for today is a different section from the Torah portion. Rabbi Joseph is going to share some words of Torah, and we'll learn, and we're going to do a musaf again. And so that's the general layout. It'll be a somewhat familiar structure, a little bit different. There'll be some different faces, but I anticipate the same spirit. And to do that, I need everyone here that showed up yesterday. That not just showed up here in sitting in your seats, but show up in mind, body, and soul. You know, there's a verse from a midrash or from the Mishnah that says, "Open the door to repentance, as tiny as the eye of a needle, and I will open the gates wide enough to let carts and horse-drawn carriages drive through it." Let me read it again. Says, "Open a door to repentance as tiny as an eye of a needle, and I will open your gates wide enough to let carts and horse-drawn carriages drive through." So what's that mean? Someone give me your 2 second take. What does it mean to you? Jesus.
A little bit of willingness.
Okay, willing. Yes, certainly willingness.
And that'll open up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right, so it's showing up both in your willingness, showing up in your heart, and then jumping into the process, right? And even the whole, the pathway that might seem so narrow is all we have to work to step into. And then the expansiveness comes after that. So it's not just enough to show up and sit down in your seats, but it means showing up and looking for that expansiveness, showing up and being open to find a hole big enough for your soul to be carried along with the carts and horse-drawn carriages. And that's what this process is about. And we do that, we'll start with a prayer of gratitude. It's going to start with our own Nicole S. And we are looking forward to your words of wisdom.
Hi, my name is Nicole, and I'm a very grateful member of this community.
I'm Nicole.
All right. I'm so nervous. Sorry. This text hits home. That's why my higher power blessed me with Rabbi Carrie as my spiritual. Sometimes I walk into her room with a fake smile and fake laughter. I'm not letting her in. I'm not going to cry today. I chant in my head as if I'm about to play or perform. Not today, Nicole. But then, with one look and a deep breath, I'm seen. She breaks my walls I've built so carefully, crashing completely down, and finds her way in. I will never be able to thank her for everything she has given and gotten me through so far. Even this text, she called me on my bullshit from home nonetheless. I'm giving definitions. I tried to fill this passage built here's the truth. My soul feels one day at a time, and hold on. This text for myself makes me think about my addiction. When I'm using, although I'm not technically asleep, it sort of feels that way because I've numbed my brain and tricked it into thinking that I'm all better. I don't feel the pain of my world around me. I'm dead inside. Now that I'm in recovery, my soul has returned, awakened, and although it's not completely back, I absolutely know I'm repairing it sober. I feel grateful when I awaken, for I have a new day to face and a new day to work towards being reunited with my children. Thank you, Rabbi Carrie, for seeing me.
Thank you, Nicole, for showing up and sharing and being willing to walk into that narrow pinhole, that narrow hole as small as the top of a needle, to be able to share words that go out much in a much more greater expanse. So the prayer that traditionally said every morning is, Moda ani lefanecha melechai v'kaya, Shehechazarte bi nishmati bechemach rabba munetecha. Says, I am grateful to you, ruler, sovereign of living in existence, for you have returned my soul to me with compassion, with mercy. Abundant is your faithfulness. So it's a statement of deep gratitude, but it's also a statement that I'm here and that being here is a gift. And I can acknowledge that gift, and I can use it to give me focus and give me intention for the actions that I take in the coming day. So we acknowledge the gift that we have for being returned to this day, and now we can acknowledge the gifts that we have for this space, the holy space that we're in, the sanctuary, the tents that we fill with our own spirits. I think we do that by jumping into Ma Tovu.
Ma Tovu lecha Yaakov, Ma Tovu Mishkenotecha, 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 Israel. Oh, how lovely are your tents, oh Jacob, your dwellings, Israel. Your abundant kindness lets me know that all will soon be well. Ma tovo lecha Yaakov, Ma tovo lecha Yaakov, mi Mishkenotecha, 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 Yisrael. Let me be humble and quiet with all the love that I carry. I bow down to you with reverence in this sanctuary. Matovo lecha Yaakov, Matovo lecha Yaakov. Mishkenotecha, Mishkenotecha, Mishkenotecha,
so if we start with gratitude for the moment, gratitude for the morning, and we move towards gratitude for the space, then we can bring our focus to gratitude for our body. The prayer, the song that many of you may know, Asher Yatzar, is inspired by this prayer. The prayer is, praise are you, Lord our God, sovereign of the universe, who has fashioned the human body with sublime wisdom, creating an intricate network of veins, arteries, structures, and organs, each of which must function properly for our survival. Praised are you, O Lord, who heals all creatures and performs wonders. So it's an acknowledgement of the intricacies, the complexities, and marvels at the wonders of how everything fits together. In a physical form that reflects the complexities of a creator that's certainly beyond our comprehension. So we know that, and we can see the complexities of the body, but we can't always, we feel the complexities of the soul. And so we move from gratitude for the body to gratitude for the soul. We have two speakers that are going to share a little bit about their appreciation, two different people that are at different parts and different parts of their own path that can give us some inspiration. So we're going to have Ryan N. come up and speak about gratitude for his soul first.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Ryan N., grateful member of this community. All right, so I'm doing my drashas on gratitude for the gift of the soul. It reads as, my God, the soul with which you endowed me is pure. You created it, you formed it, you breathed it into me, and you preserve it within me. A time will come when you will reclaim it from me, but you will return it to me in the life to come. So long as the soul is within me, I thank you, Lord my God and God of my ancestors, sovereign of all creatures, Lord of all souls. Praised are you, O Lord, who has restored me to a new day of life. I am a fear-based creature. I respond to emotions differently. When my soul is being smothered by fear, it's a one-way ticket to shame. On this path, there's no stopping, no veering off. Bottom is my only destination, and despair, a second home. 8 months ago, I was drunk, sitting at a poker table. I had just withdrawn my last $600. For some reason, I was feeling off. Not because I was faded, it was because my head was unbearably loud. One voice was telling me, Ryan, you can't win back what you don't put in the middle. You've been here before. You love a good underdog story. Those are the best wins. The other voice was afraid because I knew what was next to come. With every gambling relapse, I inevitably fall deep into the red. Maxing out credit cards, taking out loans, and selling everything I own is a factual reality of my disease. I didn't know what to do. It was 4 a.m. at Morongo Casino, and I was hammered, in a split, and alone. To my surprise, I did something strange. I paused. I started to survey the room. I remember feeling disgusted. We were all miserable-looking zombies, just selling our time. No one was happy, especially me. I was dying on the inside. In a moment of clarity, I came to, and my soul was able to reveal itself. It was screaming out to me. I was in disbelief. It actually disrupted my spiral. Every fiber in my body felt its purity. I did another strange thing. I stood up and I walked away. For the first time in my life, I had had enough. That morning, my soul had restored me to sanity. I haven't placed a bet since. Hope is the only thing stronger than fear. And this action to stop was life-affirming. Everything I've been doing has been affirming that choice. Every action I've taken in recovery is affirming my soul. I will never forget that moment. I will never forget that when I pause, my soul comes forth. Thank you, God, for preserving it within me.
Thank you, Ryan. So that sense of enoughness, that call to the soul that Phil talked about yesterday, runs deep. Sometimes we're blessed to pay attention. I know we have someone else, we have a community member from the outside, from our outside 8831, Dana. Dana Gash is here to offer another perspective on Elohai Neshama, on gratitude for the soul.
Thanks so much, Adam. Thank you very much for giving me this portion. And I'm so honored to do this with Ryan. That's amazing. I am Dana Gash, the mother of two former residents, Luca and Jules. And I'm extremely honored to be a member of this community. And I want you residents who I don't know out there, all you guys in the sanctuary, you need to know that there is a big community here that are with open arms, rooting for you, caring for you, and loving you. So just know that. And I can't wait to meet you. I can't wait till we're all in person. The definition of soul is the vital core. My soul is my internal and eternal map. My soul, so deep inside of me, has been touched solely by God, thus not scarred by molestation or rape, nor humiliation, nor addiction, nor abandonment, nor loneliness. My soul is only wrapped in the results of my own choices. The wrapping is embossed with my clouded views and reflections of the experiences in my life. In turn, my future choices in this world, when disconnected from my soul, are not always good ones. In fact, they're downright bad, some of them. The further removed from my soul, the more I believe the lies that I tell myself. Sometimes I feel so lost, my layers of scars making my soul so hard to find. But then there's prayer and there's gratitude to my God. And I'm miraculously reunited with my lost soul. In gratitude for my soul, I'm kept mindful not to be blinded by my wrappings, by my material world trappings. I'm reminded of what's so easy to forget just looking in the mirror. It is gratitude for the gift from God of my soul that prevents me from wallowing in self-hatred and self-pity. It awakens me. It reveals again and again to me, I'm not my trespasses. Those thoughts are merely the deception of illusion. My soul is pure and it is unscathed. It is my true authentic self that my id is powerless over. It is a gift from God that can never ever be amended or adorned. It is a ray of perpetual light. It is one of a kind. Thank you, God, for the gift of my very perfect soul. Thank you for guiding me and thus revealing to me your gift, my pearl, my soul. Thank you.
Dana, you got a lot of love from the folks here. And that sense of being able to tap into or reconnect back to core essence, like you said, comes in different forms and in different shapes for different people. But we know that song is a huge part of that. And so Cantor Nate, I think, can lead us and help us to open up that point on the needlehead and find some expansiveness through Elohai Neshama. You'd get BTS Unplugged today, this morning.
That's what it is.
But it touches that soul in a different way.
It's a different vibe.
It's a different vibe. All right, for a slightly different, even different vibe, Josh S., will you come up and join us?
Yeah. My name's Joshua. And I'm so thankful to be a part of this community.
Joshua.
Okay. So my reading was a single person. Only a single person was created in the beginning. To teach that if an individual causes a single person to perish, Scripture considers as though an entire world has been destroyed. And if anyone saves a single person, Scripture considers it as if a whole world has been saved. A little over 6 months ago, I came into BTS with my world shattered and in shambles. Such a small and sad existence, full of pain and heartache. With the care and protection of God, the time and space BTS has given me, the mentoring and friendship of Rabbi Joseph, the direction of my sponsor, and my willingness to do the uncomfortable work, myself and my world began to blossom. I stand here today with an open mind and an open heart, which have been closed off for so long. There is a Buddhist teaching which says underneath the superficial self, the ego, the one that clamors for this or that, there is another self, which is more really us than an I. And in becoming aware of this self, this unknown self, the more you become aware of it, or the more I become aware of it, the more I realize that we're inseparably connected with everything else there is. That I, we, are a function of this entire universe. Now, this is just my belief, that in this sacred space and in this sacred moment, we are all connected. And through this process and the 12 steps of recovery of Alcoholics Anonymous, I've been able to reconnect and continue to have a new experience with myself. I've been able to connect and continue to have new experiences with a higher power of my own understanding. And I've been able to connect and continue to have a new experience with my fellows. In turn, I've gotten to build and recreate my life and my world hand in hand with my Creator. And after having a spiritual awakening as a direct result of these steps, I'm able to now take men through this process, which has helped me discover my passion and purpose. And if I can help or guide one man to cultivate and connect to a relationship with a higher power of his own understanding, so that he may flourish and blossom, then all of my pain and heartache were worth it. Thank you.
Thank you, Josh. Right, we'll make sure that that pain and heartache is worth it. When we do that, we can celebrate the process to walk through pain and heartache to find out how we can be of service and lift up others. We draw upon celebration with shouts and chants of joy with Hallelujah and Psalm 150.
Hallelujah, 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 shofar, hallelujah, benevel vechinor, hallelujah, betof umacho, hallelujah, beminim beugav, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, betzirzel neshama. Go hashama te hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
There we go. Yeah. Let's go. We are here. Right. Today is the birthday of the world. It's cause to celebrate and cause to acknowledge that we didn't create this world, but we're here, and it's a gift to be here. Acknowledging that acknowledges that there's a sovereign greater than ourselves. That comes to acknowledge the king, is the imagery, the sovereign that runs throughout this season. And we can sing to that with HaMelech.
Shemo vechato raneno tzadikim badonai la isharim navatehi la mefi isharim titala. V'divrei tzadikim tedbarach, uvilashon chasidim titkadash, uvekerev kedoshim
So the prayer that Cantor Nate just sang, HaMelech, ends with, amidst the holy you are praised. The prayer talks about God as sovereign, as king on a throne. This powerful imagery that in times could be so unfathomable to connect with, especially in our modern day sensibilities. But it ends and it says, like I said, amidst the holy you are praised. So acknowledging God's holiness or something distant, the holiness is also in the community, amidst the holy. That's us. That's where we're at. It's not necessarily where the focus is on the throne, but it's also about who's in the seats. So we're in the seats. We're here to gather, and we gather traditionally with a barhu. It's a call to prayer. It's a communal call to prayer. So we can gather and start.
Baruch Adonai Ha-Mevorach Ha-Mevorach
So we've arrived, we've gathered, we've tapped into gratitude. We acknowledge that it's not just about us. And now we're called to focus on one of the central prayers of the liturgy, the Shema. And we'll have Ran come up and share some words of wisdom.
I am really nervous. I've spoken in front of many crowds before, but I've never been this nervous because I've never cared about as many people as I care about here.
You're
gonna make me cry. Good morning. My name is Ran.
Hi, Ran.
I am a Olympic level alcoholic and a very grateful member of this community. I'm blind when I look this way, but here it's clear, so bear with me as I try to look as I go out. So I was asked by Adam Chaplin to write a drash for the Shema prayer for today's services. The prayer goes, "Listen, Israel, Adonai is our God, Adonai is one. Blessed is the name. The glory of God's kingdom is forever and ever." Now, I got to confess, as a writer, I really didn't know what to do with this. It's not a lot of words. It seems brief, and on the surface, it's very straightforward, and I didn't really know if I'd have enough to say about it, but that's where the perfection lies, in those simple words. The first mistake I made was that I kept putting I in front of everything I was reading. How would I relate to something of this prayer? What have I experienced in my life or my stay at Beit Teshuva that correlates with this invocation? And upon doing some research, it became clearer and clearer that it wasn't an I thing. It was more of an us kind of thing. One discovery that struck me the most was the certain definitions and meanings of the various words within the meditation. The two words that touched me the most were listen and love. Now, love isn't explicitly mentioned, but it's there. It's all over the place in that prayer. And in many interpretations, I read love and listen are very closely related, kind of two sides of the same coin. They're both as much a call to action as they are an emotion or a sensory activity. I also believe there's even a concept known as active listening. It's a concept I'm not very good at, but I'm trying to get better. When I first arrived at Beit Teshuva, I was outwardly grateful for my rescue. I was thanking everybody. I was also very vocal about it. I'm really good at being vocal. Some might say my spoken expressions are almost too good, or rather too much. I had my story and I was sticking to it. I'd raise my hand in groups and I'd pontificate about how much I'd suffered, how much I endured, how my life had been so unfair. But that was just a bunch of junk, a bunch of noise. I was just trying to misdirect the group so they wouldn't really see what I was doing. I didn't want anyone to know me, the real me. And conversely, I wasn't too interested in knowing anyone else either. I would say my piece and then I'd become a rehab hermit. I'd go get food, go back to my room. I'd go outside with my headphones and become an invisible member of the community. Then I'd go to my treatment team and complain about all the things I didn't like at Beit Teshuva. Asshole, yes, asshole. Again, I wasn't listening or loving. I also wasn't progressing in my recovery either. Yeah, I was killing it in the gym. I was an all-star at tanning on the men's patio. I was a self-absorbed, narcissistic jerk. It was my convenient narrative. I got to be a victim and an antisocial enigma, or more importantly, a lone wolf. And then my team, along with my sponsor and a few amazing and tough, loving residents, called me on my bullshit. As Harriet would have told me, the opposite of addiction is connection. And as much as I wanted to fight it, I needed to connect. And again, two of the most important parts of connection are listening and loving. The prayer beseeches us to do those same acts. So, over the next few weeks, I started actively trying to listen more and to love more. Funny thing happened, probably not a big surprise to everybody else but me, I stopped complaining. I began to connect to the beautiful souls within the confines of this magical place. And every one of you is beautiful. Every one of you is beautiful. Every one of you is beautiful. Everyone in the world is beautiful. It's true. I take a lot of photographs of you guys. I'm always walking around with the camera, sometimes getting invasive, trying to get pictures of you, taking pictures of staff, services, you know, picnics, anywhere I can get pictures. I do it for creative matters, but I really do it for myself too, because it's a gift I can give and also a gift I receive. And one of the things I've learned in my 2+ decades of being a photographer is that you can see an entire lifetime in the eyes of every subject you photograph. You can see their joy, their fear, their courage, their broken hearts, but what you almost always see is love. And that love makes every single one of you in here and on Zoom beautiful. You may not feel it at times, I know I don't, but sometimes when I go back and look at pictures of myself when I thought I was in pain and I look into Rand's eyes, I do see love. And I would encourage you, when you're not in that place, to go find a picture of yourself and just look into your eyes, and you will see it too. I also have the privilege of writing the resident spotlights as part of my work with Creative Matters. I love to write. I love going from a blank screen with a blinking cursor to crafting a story that both engages and moves the reader. And I'm one of the luckiest people at Beit Teshuva, because every week I get to interview a resident, and they give me a gift I can never repay. They connect with me and tell me their life story. It's incredibly vulnerable and brave on their part. They lay bare their souls to some guy in rehab they don't really know that well. And they trust me to tell their story accurately and lovingly. And the only way I can do that is to listen, connect, and love. I take it deadly serious. You become my family. You love me. And I love you, even if it doesn't feel like it sometimes. I am, after all, still a work in progress. Please forgive me as I continue to do my best to listen, love, connect, and grow. And I also now understand the deep emotions that alumni, staff, and residents always express when describing their experience here. There are just as many tears shed as there are smiles. We're in a very exclusive club. We're all addicts. But we're all addicts at Beit Teshuva. We're all addicts at Beit Teshuva during a pandemic. We're all addicts at Beit Teshuva where for a while we could only leave the room for 1 hour and go back. And we still held on and we stuck it out because of the love we received and the love we gave. It's not easy to get in here. You have to go through hell first. But when you do arrive, you experience a kind of love that only we understand. They out there don't get it. They will never get it, and that makes us special. So I guess now when I read the Shema, I don't see a simple prayer anymore. In fact, I see something extremely deep and powerful. As part of my new RAN project, I start my day with meditation and prayer. And when I got here, I wasn't what you would really call a strong prayer. When I pray to God, I ask her to help me listen and be of service to my community at Beit Teshuva, as well as my community outside these walls. And yes, my higher power is a female, and she is spectacular. And then I go about my day doing my best to connect, listen, and love. And what I've discovered is that it's a hell of a lot more enriching to do those things than hide behind my fear of how I'll be thought of or viewed. Love is indeed an action. Listening is an action. Connection is an action. And when I put listening, loving, and connection into action, I not only become part of something much bigger than myself, I also become closer to Randall and to God.
Thank you, Wolf. As we said, the second part of the Shema talks about loving with all your heart. So let that focus as we enter into the Shema.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha. בכל לבבך ובכל נפשך ובכל מאודך והיו הדברים האלה אשר אנוכי מצווך היום על לבבך ושיננתם לבניך ודיברת בם בשבתך בביתך ובלכתך בדרך ושוכבך ובקומך ושרתם לעוד הידך והיו לטוטפות בין עיניך וכתבתם על מזוזות ביתך ובישעריך.
Jewish services are broken up with Kaddishes. And so we're going to, except we're having somewhat of an unconventional service today. We're going to have a Kaddish Shalem, and then we're going to break and do some learning. So we're at a transition point.
Be'al amad nivrach yurte ve'amnech malchote Be'chayeh ono mechon uv'hayeh decho beit Yisrael Ba'agala uv'izman kariv Ve'hi imero yehesh me'rabah me'varach Le'olam u'me'omayim Bechata v'shirata Tush bechata v'nechemata Damiran be'alma Tush bechata v'nechemata Damiran be'alma ya Israel kadam uvahon divishmaya vehi imero yehesh me rabah min shamaya vechayim aleinu aleinu vehayinu ve'akol Yisrael ve'akol Yisrael ve'akol Yisrael
Here's how this is going to play out. We are shortly. We're going to have not a break. We're going to separate. There's going to be some multiple learnings. The people in the sanctuary will be learning with myself and Rabbi Carey. We're going to break up into two different groups. I'll give instructions, and then we're going to alternate after about 25 or so minutes. The people on Zoom, I was told to look at the camera. Hi, everyone. So you guys, the folks on Zoom, there'll be no breakout rooms. You're going to stay together as a learning cohort. You're going to be learning with first Rabbi Joseph and then Rabbi Miriam, also about 25, 30 minutes each. We're going to aim to wrap this part of the service up around 11:45. We're going to take a 15-minute break again. Residents, there'll be snacks and some refreshments out in the coffee bar. So if you got hungry yesterday, then make sure that you grab some stuff. We're going to start back at noon as scheduled for our Torah service and Musaf, and then we're going to wrap. Before we do, though, I can't express enough gratitude. Gratitude has been the theme for the morning. Enough gratitude for Cantor Nate. The amount of work that he and his ability to show up day after day is indescribable. Tony's on the keyboard. Jesse's behind the camera. Mike C. Who else we got there? We got Mickey, Brandon, Kay. We got the PFs. We have a lot of rabbis that this would not have been possible if they didn't bring their full effort and soul. Max is like way hidden, but deep burrowed in the inside of Beit Shuva, but it does not happen without Max. So Max gets a huge shout out. All right, so like I said, we're going to do some learning. So dive in, nourish your spirit, nourish your brain, nourish your heart, and nourish the connection being part of a learning community. For those that are in the room, we're going to... Okay, so here we're going to make it simple. Michael, Daniel, and Bob, everyone that is to your left, stay here. Everyone that is to your right, you can go in the group rooms. And then we'll switch in about 25 minutes or so. Okay. Oh yeah, we're causing all sorts of chaos.
Shana Tova, everybody. Hello. It's so good to see so many faces on Zoom, and that we get to learn together this Rosh Hashanah. We're gonna go till about 11:19. So give us about, I don't know, I can't do the math. However, 26 minutes. So let's just jump into it. How's that? And I'm hoping that this learning is going to be a conversation, and that we can connect through the text and see ourselves in the text as well. So Rosh Hashanah is called Yom Hadin, the Day of Judgment. Well, where does this come from? It doesn't really say that in the Torah, but the rabbis bring about this idea. Okay, and we're gonna go through some text right now, so I hope everybody can see that. But this is one of the first teachings in the Mishnah of the Talmud about Rosh Hashanah. And it says, I'm reading over here, at four set times the world is judged. So it's not just Rosh Hashanah. On Passover, with respect to the produce, on Shavuot, with respect to the fruit of the tree, on Rosh Hashanah, all the people of the world pass before God, kivnei maron, like b'nei maron. And that's going to be the focus of this teaching. How are we judged? What does it mean to be b'nei maron? Because as it says, he who creates the hearts of them all, who understands all their actions. Right? So that's a little verse. That one's the only one with a proof text. Oh, and on Sukkot, they are judged in respect of rain. Okay, so three of the three pilgrimage holidays, Passover, Shavuot, and Sukkot, were judged in respect to the land, basically, on the produce, the fruit, and the rain. But on Rosh Hashanah, it's a special type of judgment. We are judged according that each one of us passed before God, kivnei maron, like the children, like the nation of Maron. What the heck does that mean? Anybody in Hebrew, right, know what Kivnei Maron means? Right? Good, because I don't know what it means either. Anyone want to take a stab? Yeah? Is that you, Yehuda? Okay, so good.
Yeah, I don't know. Sorry.
No, it's all good. Good. Usually what happens is when there's a difficulty in the text, there's going to be a lot more commentary around it, right? That's why this one gets a little proof text. But the Gemara, the Talmud, they spell it out, and there's three different meanings, okay? So this is a little bit later in the Talmud, where they're going to expand on what it means, okay? The Mishnah teaches on Rosh Hashanah, all people, all creatures pass before God, Kivnei Maron, like B'nei Maron. And the Gemara asks, well, what is the meaning of this phrase? What does it mean? And there's three answers given, okay? Here in Babylonia, they interpret it to mean one like a flock of sheep, Kivnei Imarna, right? So this sounds like a little bit the same, Kivnei Maron, Kivnei Imarna, to symbolize we're a flock of sheep that pass before God on the day of judgment, okay? Option number one, Reish Lakish disagrees. He says, no, Kivnei Maron is actually like the ascent going to the house of Maron, which there's a Mount Maron near Sfat in Israel. And this ascent is very steep and narrow, meaning only one person can pass at a time. Okay, so number one, we're judged potentially like a flock of sheep. Number two, individually one by one. And then Rav Yehuda said in the name of Shmuel, another opinion. Kechayalot b'nei David, like the soldiers of the house of King David. All right, does that clarify everything for you guys? All right, now you know how we're being judged on Rosh Hashanah. Right, Stan? Right, it's perfect sense. Okay, I'm still confused, right? What does it mean that we are judged either like a flock of sheep, like on the ascent to Maron, or like soldiers of the house of King David? And I'm curious just to hear maybe some thoughts and reflections here. And I'll keep the text up if anybody wants to raise their hand or unmute.
I think it can go one of two ways. A flock of sheep might be referring to like the nation of Israel as a whole.
Okay, the flock is like the entire nation, okay.
And then individually is self-explanatory, like as individuals.
Okay, great. What about the third one? What about like the soldiers of King David's army?
I think it's similar to as individuals.
Okay. Adam's take right there. Anybody else? What's the stand? Go for it.
Well, it seems to say the last one, we're each judged individually for what we're doing, and soldiers in King David's army kind of is like talking to me about being, like they say in AA, we're in the army, we're soldiers working together to stay sober, to advance Judaism. So we're bayahad, we're together.
Okay.
And who wouldn't want to be in King David's army? That would be awesome. And cool. We are in King David's, right? We are in King David's army, kind of spiritually.
Great. So like there's a sense communally, but also the privilege and honor to be in that prestige of serving the king so intimately, right? But then the question is what's the difference between the flock in the first one and King David's army? Yeah, Dana's good. Dana jumped up. Go for it, Dana.
Well, the flock of sheep is submissive, and where the army is on the defense is assertive.
Okay, so
the third one I didn't hear. I had to leave the room for a second. So, but that's what struck me. I was hearing you from the other room speaking, and that immediately came to my mind.
Yeah, the flock of sheep is kind of like a herd, right? Like there's
following,
kind of following the communal path, right? We're kind of all responsible to each other, but there's something different about the army, right? There's, you say on the defensive, I'll share my take in a little bit, right? What else? There's something different between, obviously since there's three opinions stated, they must mean different things. Otherwise they wouldn't have made it into the Talmud.
One is passive and one is aggressive. And I don't know what that middle one was. Like, I didn't hear.
Okay, the middle one was like the ascent to to the house of Maron, which is individually, right? It's a narrow path that only one person can cross at the same time. And actually I remember like climbing Mount Maron, and I was like, where is this path? Where is this path? And then actually pretty tragically earlier this year, there was a stampede during Lag BaOmer where a lot of Israelis were killed, and it kind of symbolized this right there. Okay, so there's a couple of hands up. I'm gonna do Steve, Kathy, and then Cheryl.
Hi, I'm Steve. I'm a grateful member of this community. Thank you for asking me to participate. I see the flock of sheep as I've seen flocks of sheep. The sheep really are somewhat indifferent to one another.
Mm.
They are really, they recognize this belonging to other sheep compared to other animals like cows or wolves, but they're kind of indifferent to one another. And in the army, A, you're kind of taught to relate to one another, and B, particularly in times of stress or conflict, you have one another's back.
Ooh.
Each one of you knows that your life depends on the other sheep or the other soldier, because, and his depends or hers depends upon you. And that's a real different take. And I think the sense of, I don't know that sheep know that they're in a herd. They know they're within a bunch of sheep. The army knows they're moving forward with a mission.
Okay.
They have a direction.
I love that, Stephen, right? And I'm not a shepherd, so I don't know exactly how flock of sheep move, but I think there is that, like.
Flocks of sheep only move, excuse me to interrupt, because they have sheep herders and right. Collies to make a move.
Somebody's in that, right? Like.
And the third one is really a whole other take, this individual passing individually, like you're separate from. I resonate with the other two more, and especially, although I don't like the militaristic implication with the army, because as Israelites, we are on a mission to spread light to our fellow members of the herd who perhaps are not Israelites.
Great. So there's this responsibility piece, right? That in the Talmud it says, "Kol Yisrael aravin ze laze." Each Israelite is responsible for one another, and that's being invoked as well in the soldiers of King David. I love that. I think that's a beautiful take, Stephen. Kathy.
Hi. Good morning, everyone. I also get this when they're talking about the individual. It's almost like each person is going through a kind of a judgment day that they have to pass muster. And the militaristic part of it is maybe they just have the military around in case they feel they're going to have a problem with someone if they don't feel belong.
Okay, I don't follow it exactly, Kathy. Say it again.
It's just a matter, I think, that we're all being judged one by one, the individual part of it.
Okay,
it's
so you're
judgment day.
Right. So you like the middle one, like B'nai, like the ascent, individual. Oh. Right? You're you're more of a Reish Lakish opinion. Great. Great. That's the one you like too. And I know Cheryl, you
Hi. I prefer an integration of the three. And I think of it, for me, just what came to mind was heart and soul and action, where judged the individual is the heart, right? What's in our heart. To me, a soul, it's more in the collective sense, when we're in community, right? And then to me, the soldiers is action. Our actions are judged, our heart, our community, how we are in relation to other people. I don't know.
Okay, great. Beautiful, beautiful take. I think all of these are good answers. Anybody else want to jump in? Okay, so, Rick, go for it. Hi, Rick. What's up, man?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Amazing. I was just wondering if we could look at the word maroon and derive some context from either the word itself or any of the techniques that you might know of to analyze a word. So whether it has a certain number or interesting things about its characters, like the letters. So I could have more of an understanding of what the word maroon means. Right?
So that's exactly what the rabbis of the Gemara do. They translate it as sheep, right? Kibnei Imarna. From in Babylonian, in Aramaic, basically. They take Maron to mean this place. And then Shmuel just kind of throws out his other thing. I don't know what it means. It's not clear.
So is Maron a word that we don't know a certain meaning of? Because in this text, it says, what does the phrase, the name Maron mean? And I thought that's what they were getting at. Like, what does the phrase mean? But the word itself.
It's unclear.
Unclear. Okay, excellent. Can we get any information from like the numbers, right? Like if you add the letters together, you get numbers and okay. Interesting.
I didn't look up a dictionary, but there's an Aramaic dictionary that might have some, but I didn't do that. So okay. I don't know.
Excellent.
And the numbers don't necessarily, it's not always the best way to translate.
Okay. Just a question. I was trying to understand more of what the word itself meant.
Exactly. That's what this is all about. What does it mean that we are being judged? Kivnei Maron, like B'nei Maron, like the children of Maron, right? Mm-hmm. And that's these different... And this is the beauty of the rabbinic tradition, is that when there's a difficulty, when there's a question that doesn't make sense in the original, all these commentaries come in. That's where Jewish thought, right, is able to invoke these different ideas. Okay. I'll just share, like, the part of the reason I every Rosh Hashanah I think about this text is that I remember I was on it was called the Sinai Retreats. It was about, I don't know, 12 years ago now, where I was in the Adirondacks in New York, and it was this Jewish retreat where we were learning, and I wasn't really into it. It was like a lot of younger 18, 20 year olds. I was 29 at that point. I was like, this isn't really what I'm looking for. And this guy, Dennis, who had kind of seen me lurking and wandering and really like rolling my eyes maybe a little too much, pulls me aside and he's like, come here, I want to show you something. And he puts this text in front of me. And we learn it together. And he asks me, okay, well, when it comes to being in the army, right? Who goes to the army? If you were a king and you had to get people into the army, who would you go? Would it just be the best of the best? Would it just be the strongest? Who does it? Does somebody who has asthma or has, you know, glasses or maybe a disability, do they make it into the King's Army?
They're given desk jobs.
They're given desk jobs, right? At least in Israel, for sure. Maybe somebody is interprets language, has a language skill that is better, right? It's not just the strong of the strong that make it into the army. It's whatever your gift might be, whatever your skill that you have, you serve something greater than yourself. And what Dennis was telling, he's like, so what do you think? You're a frontline soldier? What are you, a commander? Maybe somebody from the Mossad? I don't know, a secret service agent? Like, who are you in this army? Right? And according to Dennis, and what I really like is we're judged on Rosh Hashanah as well based on our potential, on what gifts we have at our disposal, and are we using it to serve something greater than ourselves? Right? So being able to be judged, right? Inviting ourselves on this day of judgment on Rosh Hashanah to imagine that all three are correct, right? That we have some sense of flock responsibility, right? We have to move according, like sheep being guided by leaders, right? There is some communal responsibility. At the same time, take two, individually, one by one, God sees who we are and we're judged accordingly. But then the third part is, okay, we're judged based on our potential. We're judged based on our ability to use the gifts that we have at our disposal to make the world a better place. Are we doing that? And are we reflecting on this year, on this day, on how we've done the past 365 days? Rick, do you have your hand up again, or was that from before?
Yeah, just when you were saying about what Dennis told you, I'm reminded of a story. I think is it King David to go take the land from the Midianites? I'm not sure what the person was, but he assembles an army, and then there's like so many people that he's like, hey, you know, actually, we're going to like tear this down a little bit. So there's a series of tests, and eventually it's just like a handful of people. And the idea was, hey, we're going to do this so that everyone will say, hey, you know, God did this, not like all of you guys. Right, and I was wondering if that concept would relate with what you were sharing about the who serves in the army.
Right, that's the original 300, right? The story of Gidon and the original 300, where there are so many soldiers coming that they say, the test is who's gonna, how they drink the water from the sea. I'm getting a 5-minute warning. And based on how they drink the water, those are the people who are chosen. And a band of 300, there's a great movie about the Greeks and the Persians, but the original one was in the book of, the book of Judges. So thanks for that, Rick. Yeah. Okay, so, but guess what? There's always more, okay? So I wanted to bring two other takes for our community alone. These are a couple of other commentaries that I thought were really important. Source number three, okay? This is from the Ben Ishchai, Rabbi Yosef Chaim of Baghdad. He was an incredible scholar, Kabbalist, halach, legal posek. And he says, the language of Maron is chirut, freedom. Okay, it means just like as our sages say, they pass before God like a free nation. And a person will have freedom by the strength of the mitzvot, right? So take number four, we are judged on our ability to choose, our ability to be free, our ability to see what our choices are, and do we choose covenant? Do we choose sacred tasks of the mitzvot, or do we choose to waste away what our choice might be? Okay, take four. And then number five, which I also really love in Beit Shuva, right? Ovadia Bartanura from Italy, he ended up making Aliyah to Israel where he died. He says, Kivnei Maron are like rebels. After surrender, brought before a court martial, right? So if we take these five concepts, right? Now, I don't know about you. I don't actually think God is up in heaven with a book open, taking note of us in a book, right? It's not my theology. But what I think is important, and maybe some people do, that's okay. That's totally great. What I think is important is for each of us to imagine as if it was. Just like Kivnei Bar, like B'nai Maron, we have to put ourselves in that position one day a year to imagine how we're being judged communally, individually, according to our potential, according to our freedom of choice, and according to the times we've rebelled, when we've said, fuck it. And being able to kind of integrate all of those into the newness of this year, of the year to come. And so we're going to read this text in Musaf. It is written, it is part of the Unatana Tokef prayer. It is part of one of the essential piyutim, the essential liturgical poems of Rosh Hashanah. And so when we read it, and Cantor Nate's going to rock it, I'm sure, as always, how can we imagine ourselves that we are passing before God, Kivnei Maron? And maybe there's one of those five that resonate more with you today, or maybe in another time. And those are entry points to the sanctity of this day and this holiday. And I hope that helps us make 5782 that much more special and sweeter. So Shana Tova Mitzvah. I look forward to seeing you on the other side. Okay, thank you. I'm gonna give it up to Rabbi Miriam to take us home for the next session of our learning. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rabbi. Thanks, everyone.
Yes, absolutely. Yashar Koach. I was super excited to tune in for that learning because that's a phrase that I've also been curious about. So love all those explanations. And we'll see it again, Musaf, you know, in our afternoon service today. So hi, everyone. I am so excited to be learning with you a little bit this morning. There is so much to talk about. And only a brief time. So this will be a taste, kind of inspiring us to keep learning on these topics for the future. But what I want to talk about today is really inspired by this book, Seasons of Our Joy by Arthur Waskow. I have been learning it with the residents of Beit Teshuvah, and I've actually been learning it with all of you, with the community over Zoom. I've been learning with the residents for the whole past year. This is a book about the Jewish calendar and the cycle of the Jewish holidays. So went through the whole thing in detail over this past year. And I think that I brought it to the community for the first time sometime in the spring. We had a spring adult education series. And I think that's where I introduced it to this space. But it really all started with this community, the Beit Teshuvah Zoomiverse community, and this book, at least for me, in the month of July on Shabbat Chazon, when I realized that it's only July, but we're already looking towards the high holidays. So in this space with the Zoom Beit Teshuvah community, we've been learning this book since the middle of July. And we learned a little bit last Shabbat morning. I know some of you were there. We had a great conversation. And so wanted to pick up on that conversation. But also for those of you that are like, who's Rabbi Miriam and what's this book? And huh? You know, I want to zoom out a little bit and give a little orientation towards the arc of this part of the Jewish year. Okay, so I said it started at the beginning of July, but I'm checking my trusty Jewish calendar. And actually, it all started this year at the end of June, which is the 17th of Tammuz on the Jewish calendar. We have this concept that we're in the high holidays now, the 10 days of Teshuvah, Rosh Hashanah kicks it off, Yom Kippur brings it home. This is kind of like the heart of this part of the year is the 10 days of Teshuvah. But we do a lot of preparation before, and we do some celebration after. That's really important. And really, if there's one thing that you take away from this learning, is that the celebration does not end with Yom Kippur. There's a lot of celebration after. Later in the Jewish month of Tishrei or in the secular month this year of September. Don't miss the celebration. We're doing all of this spiritual work and we want to reap those rewards. So keep celebrating after Yom Kippur. That's the one thing that I want everyone to take home from this learning today. But so rewinding back to the beginning of the story. Okay, we know that the month of Elul, the month before Rosh Hashanah, is a month of intense preparation. It's a month, okay, 30-day period, four-week period. We all know in the world of recovery that 30 days is a very meaningful amount of time. And so we take the 30 days before Rosh Hashanah and we're in our most intensive high holiday preparation. But it starts before then. It's 10 weeks before Rosh Hashanah, with we have these 10 special haftorahs, these 10 special selections from the prophets, from the other part of the Jewish Bible that we read on Shabbat mornings. We have 3 haftorot of admonition, followed by 7 haftorot of consolation. So we talked about that in this space. We have the 3 haftorot of admonition are about tough love, that moment where we look at what we've done and we say, we have fucked up and it's our fault. We've got to own our part. That's the only way that things are going to get better. That's the tough love. And we do that on the Jewish calendar in the heat of summer when the days have already started to get shorter. It's really all the grasses outside are kind of drying up and it's like, whoa, fire season has started. It's getting a little bit intense. We move into that space of tough love, that admonition, that knowing that we are at fault in some of the things that go on in our lives, right? Not all of them. But some of them, we got to own it. We take those 3 weeks, focus on tough love, and then we follow it with 7 weeks of consolation, compassionate love, saying, okay, you've messed up, but it's going to be fine. You know why? Because there's teshuvah. You don't have to keep messing up just because you messed up once before. You can change the way you do things and you can live a different life. You can live a better life. As we live in recovery, there's a different way of doing things. Mind-blowing. And we might, that might be a choice that we want to make is to do things differently. So that's the 7 weeks of compassionate love, the haftarot of consolation. So we have 3 of those before the month of Elul and then 4 of them in the month of Elul when things really start to get serious. Okay, so then we have the period that we're in now, the 10 days of Teshuvah, starting with Rosh Hashanah, concluding with Yom Kippur. Okay, so We've talked about this a couple of times already during this Rosh Hashanah holiday of Beit Teshuvah. We have this idea, and we talked about it last Shabbat morning as well. On Rosh Hashanah, it is written, and on Yom Kippur, it is sealed. Rabbi Joseph was just talking about this idea, this metaphor that God has a big old book in the sky and is like, okay, you, death by fire. Okay, you, ooh, prosperity, nice. Like, okay, you, career success, but some struggle with, okay, you know, and God goes for each one of us. And writes in on Rosh Hashanah in pencil what's going to be for us in the next year. Okay, so then we have the period in between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, which we're about to start. We're still in Rosh Hashanah, but as soon as the sun sets tonight, we are moving into this in-between period where we have a chance to change what God has written in pencil in the Book of Life before on Yom Kippur, God goes over it in Sharpie. And the way that we change what's written for us in our Book of Life is through our actions. We know in recovery, this is a program of action. This Jewish New Year, this Rosh Hashanah, it gives us an opportunity for Jewish New Year's resolutions. But unlike the secular New Year's resolution, where it's like, here are the things that I'd like to do, the end. you know, it's a little bit different in Jewish tradition. You say, here are the things that I'd like to do, and now I'm going to start doing them. This is the period of Jewish year where we start doing things differently. Rosh Hashanah, we resolve to do things differently. And after Rosh Hashanah and before Yom Kippur, translation, right away, we start doing things differently. And so God sees that we're doing things differently, erases the pencil, and on Yom Kippur writes something different in Sharpie. Okay, that now we had a really, really awesome concept come up in our discussion on Shabbat morning. We were having a discussion about forgiveness and what if the other person doesn't forgive. And we were talking a little bit about the program of Al-Anon and our experiences in that program. And we came up with the insight. And I think that Jana articulated it. And Jana, I think, is here somewhere on this call, that on Yom Kippur, we humans are God's qualifier. You know, where God's like, are they going to be different this time? And the humans are like, oh, we promise we will. And like, are we going to? That's the question. So we're going to come back a little bit to that idea, because I think it, I've been thinking about it since we learned that together on Shabbat morning, and it has made me understand Yom Kippur in a deeper way. So we're going to come back and talk about that at the end. Don't touch that dial. But first, we're going to talk about why the celebration does not end at Yom Kippur. Okay, so the period between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, which we are about to start, it becomes a program of action. We take our New Year's resolutions and we implement positive change in our lives. Amazing. Yom Kippur arrives. We're like, okay, here, God, we have started to work on these positive changes. We can't completely transform our life in 10 days, usually. You know, we can't necessarily completely transform our life in 30 days, usually, but we can start on that transformation. You know, this is the gift of rock bottom, right? There's one moment where we turn it around. I think if you were here on this Zoom call for the services earlier, resident Ryan N. was talking so beautifully about an experience where things just turned around for him. So that turning around only takes a moment, but making that permanent, one day at a time, positive change, you know, that's an ongoing process. But we start it before Yom Kippur, and on Yom Kippur, we come before God and say, like, we're rocking and rolling with this positive change thing, and I just want you to know, you know. And so that's what we do with God in Yom Kippur. And then afterwards, then what? We get to celebrate. We get to celebrate. The holiday season is not over. We are approaching Sukkot after Yom Kippur. So let's see. Let me get my calendar. You can all mark your calendars because this is an important time. Yom Kippur, we know, starts next Wednesday night and concludes next Thursday. And then Sukkot actually starts the evening of Monday the 20th. So just a couple of days after Yom Kippur, we start this one-week holiday of Sukkot. And this is the season of our joy. This is Zman Simchatenu. And it says in the Torah that Sukkot is the one holiday throughout the year we're commanded to rejoice and to be only happy. To be thoroughly happy, to be completely happy, to be completely in joy and celebration. And Sukkot is considered to be the most important holiday of the year. And okay, so this is the book, Seasons of Our Joy. Sukkot is known as the season of our joy. That's like, so in that way, Sukkot is the highlight of the Jewish year. And so why is this? So we've had this whole really deep spiritual conversation with God and with ourselves about how we're going to transform our life. We do that in the two-week period before Sukkot. But really, Sukkot is a culmination of the entire year. Agriculturally, in terms of the land of Israel, where the Jewish calendar originally comes from back in the day, this time of year is the harvest season. We gather in all of the pomegranates and we harvest the grapevines and we gather in all of the grains and we store everything up for the winter, because the land isn't going to produce in the same way in the winter as it does, of course, in the growing and harvest seasons. And so this is the time of year where we get all cozy and ready for winter. And we're like, we did. Harvest is over. That was a lot of work we did. We started in the spring with planting and we cared for our crops all summer. We're harvesting them in the fall. And this is fulfillment. This is the moment where, like, wow, not only do I have all I need right now, I have all I need to last me through the winter season. Ooh, that is a cozy feeling. And so that's part of what the joy of Sukkot is all about. Now, spiritually, you know, we get to reap the harvest of our spiritual work between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. But remember, we didn't just start that work at Rosh Hashanah. We started 10 weeks before. We went through the tough love. We went through the compassionate love. We went through the program of action. And now we get to celebrate all that we've done. So there's like the historical agricultural piece of that fulfillment and joy at Sukkot. But we also have our personal spiritual journey that we've been on, you know, for the past 10 weeks, that really is a culmination of everything in the past year. And we get to rejoice with all we've done, you know, appreciate the good that we've done, appreciate the success that we've had. That's what Sukkot is all about. And not only do we get to do that for an entire week on Sukkot, there's this little known holiday that became a much better known holiday. It's called Shmini Atzeret, the eighth day of ingathering, which is not so much of a catchy name, but it became Simchat Torah, the rejoicing of the Torah. And so this holiday at the very, very end of Sukkot is actually a special holiday unto itself. In our modern day, it became a celebration of restarting the Torah reading. We've got some of the best stories in the book of Genesis that come in the fall. So it's like getting psyched for that restarting of the Torah reading. But in terms of what the Torah's origins, when you actually read, why do we celebrate this extra festival at the end of Sukkot? I mean, we've had Rosh Hashanah, 2 days of it. We've had Yom Kippur, kind of a big deal. Sukkot, a week-long holiday. Do we really need one more holiday after that? And God says, yes, actually we do, because we need an after party. Every great party has an after party, right? You party, you do the thing, you see the people, you enjoy the food, it's so great. And then you have a little bit of an extra thing before you go home. And that's what Shmini Atzeret is all about. That's the origins of our Simchat Torah celebration today. So take home message is, the celebration continues after Yom Kippur. It continues with the holiday of Sukkot, and it concludes with the after party of Shmini Atzeret and Simchat Torah. Of course, we don't have enough time right now to explain exactly what Sukkot and Simchat Torah are all about, but don't worry, I'm around, we're all around. We've got plenty of work to do between now and Sukkot. Even though it's only a week and a half away, we have a lot going on between now and then. So don't worry, we'll get there when we get there. Okay, we have about 12 minutes. I love how the Zoomiverse is so precise with time. We have about 12 minutes to talk a little bit more about this insight that came up for us last Shabbat morning of on Yom Kippur, we are God's qualifier. We're trying to communicate to God that we are changing our lives for the better, that we mean it this time, and a little bit about what that's about. So I'm gonna speak to that for a couple of minutes, and then we're definitely gonna have time for some questions and further discussion, because this space is an amazing space for learning and receiving information from all of the wonderful rabbis and teachers in our community. And it's also a space for being together and for discussion and for connection and community. So we'll have a couple of minutes for that as well, don't worry. Okay, so this is how, and we ended last Shabbat morning of learning, speaking about how on Yom Kippur, we're God's qualifier. We are pleading and saying, okay, you know, I know I made this Jewish New Year's resolution. I'm starting to put it into action, and I'm going to keep going, you know, because when we get to Yom Kippur, which we will together, God willing, next week, and we pray the liturgy, we recite the words of the Jewish liturgy. We pray the prayers that our tradition has put in our mouths, in addition to the prayers that we offer from our own hearts and our own words. And a lot of them are like acknowledging that we've done things wrong. We have messed up. We have sinned. Ashamnu bagadnu gazalnu. We have sinned this way. We have sinned that way. We have sinned the other way. We're acknowledging our mistakes for the sin that I have sinned by doing this, for the sin that I have sinned by doing that. The liturgy is full of long, long lists of all of the things that we did wrong and all of the ways that we did them wrong. And we say these prayers, we confess these sins on Yom Kippur in the plural, because we're not just standing before God by ourselves on Yom Kippur, we're standing before God with the whole community, like arms wrapped around one another. And so we're apologizing to God on behalf of ourselves, and we're apologizing on behalf of our fellow Jews and our fellow humans, because humankind messes up a lot. You know, as my new sponsor was saying, like humans make mistakes, it's what we do. And so, you know, since then, since I heard that from her a couple of weeks ago, every time I make a mistake, which has been several times since then, I think, right, this, I make mistakes because I'm a human and that's what I do. It's my responsibility to right my wrongs and fix my mistakes and apologize for the things I could have or should have done differently. But I don't have to sit in shame for the fact that I make mistakes because we're humans, that's what we do, right? And so in that spirit, we come before God, we say, these are the mistakes that we've made, but we don't have to be ashamed because this is what we do as humans, right? And we're, but still, as we offer these traditional prayers on Yom Kippur, there's this tone of pleading. Please, God, listen to us this time. Please, God, forgive us this time. Like, please, God, I know that we asked you before for forgiveness and we made more mistakes after that, but we really mean it. Listen to us, please, you know? And so framing that in the context of we're God's qualifier, super interesting, because what does God do with us, right? We're coming to God, meaning like, we mean it this time. So is God gonna, what's God gonna say? Like, here's another $1,000, no problem, you know? Or is God gonna detach with love? You know, what does that look like when God detaches from us with love? If assuming such a thing is possible, right? You know, I think that something that I come back to a lot when I teach in this community is that because we speak in recovery about a personal relationship with God, the higher power of our own understanding, which means that whatever this thing is that we understand, we've got to connect with it on a personal level. So, you know, what is that relationship like? What is that relationship about? We have lots of relationships as humans with other humans. And so in some ways, our relationship with our higher power is like the relationship that we have with another human, except God isn't a person. So it's not quite the same. How is it different? That's a hard question. And I'm not sure I have a brief answer to that. You know, it's similar and it's different. So this this relationship with God in Yom Kippur and this pleading for another chance, you know, is part of that dialogue that we have on this holiday. All right. So I think that wraps up the introduction that I wanted to give. We have a few minutes for questions, comments, concerns, connections, insights, thoughts that you've had as the result of this learning that we've done together. So I'd love to see some electronically raised hands or some actually raised hands, which I love. Oh, so let's do Dana and then Stan.
I just wanted to comment on your last line because I believe that our relationships with people should be the same as our relationships with God. I mean, but however, life is a process, you know. It's funny, the beginning of the pandemic, I taught myself how to knit and I kept waiting to get to the completion of the blanket, which I was told over and over again to ditch. And I hung with it all year and I realized it's not about the blanket. It's about the process of learning how to knit. And it's an ongoing process for me. And I think it's the same in life. There's no there. And we need to continually every year, you know, be accountable and look back again. And our relationships should be like our relationship with God. I mean, we should be treating our neighbors the same as we would treat God.
I love that. No, that's great. Seeing in another human being that divine holiness and acting as such. I love that. And being in the process and not the conclusion. I think that that's been a powerful learning, I think, for me in the pandemic as well, that where is the there that I'm rushing to? You know, sometimes I hear from people in early sobriety, like, I gotta get 30 days. I just gotta get 6 months. I gotta get a year. And I always think like 6 months will take 6 months, right? You can't rush 6 months. That's not a thing, you know, but our emotions, it can be. So super appreciate that, Dana. Thank you. Stan, please. Yeah, there you are. Yay. Sorry. No worries.
Thank you, Rabbi. And thanks everybody for being here. Happy New Year to everybody. I see some people that I've known like for 20 years from far here that they don't know me, but I know them and I won't say who they are, but thank you for supporting Beit Yeshiva all these years. I've been less than a stellar student as far as Beit Yeshiva and, you know, staying clean, but I finally made it to the point where I just, oh my God, I feel like a human being again. I don't need this stuff. I'm not going to hurt myself. And I'd like to know, what is there a Jewish teaching about self-forgiveness? You know, we ask God for forgiveness. Is there any Jewish teaching about self-forgiveness and self-compassion that you might be able to talk about?
Yeah, that's a really, really important question. And I appreciate so much that you asked it in that way. Yes, and this is newer. You know, I think that self-compassion, it's a different sort of concept than Jewish tradition. So kind of like I was saying before, the Per'ashamnu, Bagadnu, Gazalnu, Dibarnu, Dofi, where we confess to all these sins in the plural, because back in the day, but not that long ago, there was a different sort of consciousness in the Jewish community about us. There was not so much separation between me and the next person. Now, there are some drawbacks to that as well. I think that, you know, the saying that probably many of us have heard, that, like, you know, a shikr is a goy, right? You know, there's no such thing as drunks in the Jewish community. Well, actually, there are, because there are drunks in every community. But okay, you know, so when we, pardon me for a second, take a sip of coffee here. When we don't see the individuality between every individual, then that kind of, we miss out on the richness and the unique challenges and the unique gifts that everyone has. So we were kind of in that place as a Jewish community, because the idea that I am separate from you and I'm different from you and I can take this path that takes me away from the Jewish community or back to it or something like that wasn't so robust in the past when these liturgies were written. But we have a lot of new innovative liturgy. You know, the I would say the first generation of that new innovative liturgy, probably starting about 5 or 10 years ago, writing not just here are the sins that we've committed, but here are the good things that we've done. You know, there's the short confessional of here's the good things that we've done, and then long, long lists of what are the mitzvot that we've done in this past year. So innovating those concepts is something that in our modern day we're into. Self-compassion, you know, I think that's another space that rabbis like the ones here at Beit Teshuva, like us, we are kind of moving the Jewish community more into that space of self-forgiveness and self-compassion. Part of how we fuse the teachings of recovery in Judaism, part of how we recognize that each person is a holy soul. Who was it this morning? Josh S. was commenting on the teaching from the Talmud, a single person. That the world started with one human being, to teach us that one human being is an entire world. And if you save one person, you are saving an entire world. You know, so the seeds of self-compassion are deep in Jewish tradition. But I think that, you know, in our modern day, in communities like this one, that self-compassion is something that we are creating anew as a Jewish community, recognizing that on these holidays, we don't just want to reflect on the things that we've done wrong. We want to reflect on the things that we've done right. And we know that affirming who we are as a holy soul is something that helps us start a teshuva process, you know? So I think that it's not the most robust thing in Jewish tradition, like here's a Talmudic tractate on self-compassion. Okay, we don't have that. But in our day, we're blessed to be writing that, you know, as we speak and contributing to that as this community. So super appreciate that question. Oh yeah, definitely. All right. I think we've got time for one more short share or one more quick question. Oh, 5 minutes, actually four. Someone is saying that. But I think we're concluding at 11:45. So 4 minutes, something. Maybe that message was coming from before. Okay.
I just like to introduce myself.
Amazing. Hi.
Hey, I'm in quarantine at the moment. My name's Adam Y.
Welcome.
I've been like watching all the services through Zoom for the last couple of days. So just want to say I appreciate you and nice to meet you.
Oh, we appreciate you. Nice to meet you and welcome to our community. You know, as you've already heard or perhaps we'll hear again at Shabbat services, things are going to get tough. And really the one thing that you absolutely have to do is hold on.
We'll do.
Amazing. Okay, Donnie, you want to take us home with the last comment of the day?
Very quickly, I want to say that 5 years ago,
this year, your cantor Nate came to Beit Teshuvah and was in that same situation of just coming in during high holidays. And I was so glad about that because how uplifting. And he wanted nothing more than to try and connect with Laura to say, hey, could I participate? Could I sing? And and he went from there. So hang in there. Thanks. I'm glad you introduced yourself, the person who spoke before me. And I just wanted you to know that Nathan was in that same place 5 years ago.
Oh, amazing. Thank you for sharing that experience, strength, and hope and story of connection to this community. This is a beautiful time of year to have us all be together. And I am hearing very directly in the chat that we've got to take a quick pause. So don't worry, services will resume at 12 p.m. So I will catch you all very, very soon. Mwah. Shana Tova.
Thanks, Miriam, Rabbi.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, leave meeting. Okay, now I've got a call.
They can hear you.
Oh.
Oh, we're live. All right, we're just going to wait another moment until we gather in person and more of these seats are filled up. You guys can come up front. Amina, come to the front.
No, not like that.
Amina, come front row seat. We are going to do a little Torah service and a little Musaf, and we're going to get started with a song that really introduces, I know some of you guys were learning the Akedah, the Binding of Isaac, with Chaplain Adam Siegel, and this song spoke to me, so whenever you're ready, Cantor.
Stone set in your eyes, see the thorn twist in your thigh. I'll wait for you. Sleight of hand and twist of fate, on a bed of nails she makes me wait, and I wait without you. With or without you, with or without you. Through the storm we watch the shore, you give it all but I want more, and I'm waiting for you. With or without you, nothing left to lose, and you give yourself away, and you give yourself away, and you give, and you give, and you give yourself away, with or without you. Win. without you. With or without you, oh, I can live. With or without you. With or without you. With or without you. With or without you.
I think about that where we're about to read the Torah portion of the Binding of Isaac. And this is a really troubling passage of the Torah. It's got more questions than answers, more difficulties than I like to actually say. But that's part of the beauty of Torah. It's meant to make us uncomfortable sometimes. And I can't imagine a father who has been yearning for a child to be willing to do this. And so I found this poem by the Israeli poet Chaim Guri. It's called Inheritance. The ram came last, and Abraham did not know it was the answer to the boy's question. The boy, the first issue of his vigor in the twilight of his life. He lifted his hoary head. When he saw that it was no dream and the angel stood there, the knife slipped from his hand. The boy, unbound, saw his father's back. Isaac, we're told, was not offered up in sacrifice. He lived long, enjoyed his life, until the light of his eyes grew dim. But he bequeathed that hour to his progeny. They are born with a knife in their heart. Our parents have all hurt us. As loving as they might be, as great as they might be, we are all born with a little stab in our heart. And part of what this Torah story, what this portion talks about, is how we end up, how do we take responsibility and mend those wounds, I think. So we're gonna bring out the Torah right now. I want to invite Drew and Hannah to come open the ark and bring the Torah out. Okay, so, and I invite everybody to rise.
Yeah.
I might have jumped the gun on that. I got a little too excited. I forgot we had some. I haven't done Torah service in so long here that I made an error. But it's okay. It works out. We're gonna do the Torah portion. What's gonna happen now is a pretty amazing feat of technology because our Torah readers are on Zoom, and we're gonna invite people. I'm gonna share some kavanot and intentions. And there are going to be three blessings, three Torah portions that we're going to read. And so if what I say speaks to you, I invite you to stand in your spot. And for those on Zoom as well, to know that this blessing is for you. So the first portion is about Abraham being tested. He's asked by God to do something extremely difficult. And his response is, Hineni, here I am. And so, if you have felt that you have been tested, and you have had to make a difficult choice, and your response has been, Hineni, here I am, and you haven't run from that choice, I invite you to stand for this first aliyah.
Should I start? Amen. Oh, sorry.
No.
Missing.
No, not yet.
So somebody, let's see, hold this open, Jake, too. Maybe another person to come hold the Torah open.
Nope.
That's okay. Okay, so we're right here. Vayihi acharei. Right there. Bring it back. A little higher.
Bring it back.
Right back. Zoom out maybe. There you go. Vayihi. Okay. So Jana, are you good on Zoom? Do you see where I'm at?
Yes.
Let's hopefully unmute Jana as well. She good?
Yes.
Okay. So Jake, you're gonna help me say this blessing, okay?
Baruch Hu et Adonai Hamvorach.
Baruch Adonai Hamvorach Leolam Va'ed.
Baruch Adonai Hamvorach Leolam Va'ed.
Baruch atah
Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam. Asher bachar banu mikol ha'amim. V'natan lanu et Torato. Baruch atah Adonai. No ten ha-Torah.
Amen. Vayachi yachar hadvarim ha-ele v'ha-Elohim nisa et Avraham Vayomer elav Avraham Vayomer hineni Vayomer kach na et bincha et yechidcha asher ahavta et Yitzhak ולך לך אל ארץ המוריה, ועלהו שם לעולה על אחד ההרים, אשר אומר אליך, וישכם אברהם בבוקר, ויחבוש את חמורו, ויקח את שני נריו איתו, ואת יצחק בנו, ויבקע עצי עולה, ויקום וילך, אל המקום אשר אמר לו האלוהים.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher natan lanu Torat emet V'chaye olam natah betochenu Baruch atah Adonai Noten ha-Torah
Amen. Give it up for Jake.
You can stand up here.
Okay. You guys can see me, all right. Aliyah number two. After Abraham has been given this task, you guys can sit down before. After Abraham's been given this task, the text says, and they both went together. Isaac was part of, he was also willing. And so for those of you who have found somebody who is a partner in crime, I shouldn't say partner in crime, a partner in recovery, right? Too loaded of a statement. Who has found a companion through thick and thin here? I invite you to stand up for the second Aliyah. Adam, do you mind coming up?
Baruch et Adonai Hamvorach.
Baruch Adonai Hamvorach Leolam Va'ed.
Baruch Adonai Hamvorach Leolam Va'ed. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Ha'amim
V'natan lanu et torato, baruch ata Adonai, noten ha-torah.
Amen. Bayom hashlishi vaisa Avraham et enav vayar et hamakom merahok vayomer Avraham el nerav shvu lechem po imachamor v'ani v'hanar nelcha adko v'nishtachavei v'nashuva alechem v'yikach Avraham et atzei ha'ola v'yasem al Yitzhak beno ויקח בידו את האש ואת המאכלת וילכו שניהם יחדיו. ויאמר יצחק אל אברהם אביו ויאמר אבי ויאמר הנני בני ויאמר הנה האש והעצים והיה האש לעולה ויאמר אברהם אלוהים יראה לא עשה לעולה בני וילכו שניהם יחדיו.
Olam nata betochenu, baruch ata Adonai, Noten ha-Torah.
Amen. I need the mic again. Here we go. Okay. The final portion that we're going to read is the climax of the story. Abraham is about to bring the knife down to sacrifice his son, and in that last moment, an angel cries out from heavens and says, Avraham, Avraham! Abraham, Abraham, don't touch the boy. Don't touch him at all. And so for anybody about to act and do something destructive that might have hurt yourself or something else, but you heard that cry, you heard that voice from beyond to help you stop, I invite those to stand up and rise for this aliyah.
Baruch Hu et Adonai am Barak.
Baruch Adonai am
Barak le'olam va'ed. Baruch Adonai am Barak le'olam va'ed. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam asher bachar banu mikol ha'amim v'natan lanu et torato. Baruch atah Adonai noten ha'torah.
Amen. Amen. Vayam. El Hamakom Asher Amar Lo Elohim Vayiven Sham Abraham Et Hamizbeach Vayaaroch Et Haetzim Vayaakod Et Yitzchak Beno Vayasem Oto Al Hamizbeach Mimal la etzim, vayishlach Abraham. et yado, vaikach et hamaachelet, lishrot et beno, vaikrai lav, malach adonai min hashamayim, vayomer Avraham, Avraham, vayomer hineini, vayomer al tishlach yadcha el hanar, va'al ta'as lo me'uma, ki ata yadati, ki yirei Elohim ata, ולא חסכת את בנך, את יחידך ממני. וישא אברהם את עיניו, וירא הנה איל אחר, נאחז בזבח בקרניו. וילך אברהם, ויקח את האיל, ויעלהו לעולה תחת בנו. ויקרא אברהם, שם המקום ההוא, אדוני יראה אשר יאמר היום, בהר אדוני יראה.
נתן לנו תורת אמת. Bechaye olam natan betochenu baruch ata Adonai noten haTorah.
Hey, wonderful! You guys can be seated. Hey, we're gonna. Yeah, I think I need the mic, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. So while we have. Actually, I need to speak into the mic. Can I have one volunteer come up and dress the Torah as well? What we're going to do while the Torah is out, yeah, Nathan, come on up. Come on and dress, put the Torah together. Is a request for healing. There are many people in our community who are in need of healing, both body and spirit. And while the Torah is out, we wanna have, there's extra power for those words of healing. So if there's anybody on your mind, on your heart, who is in need of healing, you can go ahead and say those names right now. On Zoom, feel free to unmute or share in the chat.
Rachel Coleman Louise, Lindsay Franklin Montoya, Jerry Singh, Joan Wagner.
And so we'll do the Misha Berach blessing.
Shebeirach Avotenu Abraham Yitzhak Ve'akov Sarah Rivka Rachel Ve'leahu Yivarev Mirape Et Hacholim Oh. avotenu Abraham Yitzhak ve'Yakov Sarah Rivka Rachel ve'Leah U'yivarech v'yirapeh
May those in need of healing of both body and spirit have a refuah shlema, and let us say amen. It's a pleasure to actually introduce our congresswoman who has a video message for us today, Congresswoman Karen Bass. So we're going to play that video for us.
Hi, I'm Congresswoman Karen Bass. As a physician assistant at LA County Hospital 35 years ago, I saw the worst effects of addiction driven at the time by the crack cocaine epidemic. I am grateful to have a community and a resource like Beit Shavah within my congressional district. Here they see and treat the whole person and work to help people understand that we don't have to struggle through uncertainty alone. I am always inspired by your personal stories of hope and redemption, and I wish you all a sweet and happy new year. I have been asked to read the prayer for our country, written by Louise Ginsburg. Our God and God of our ancestors, we invoke your blessings upon our country, on the government and leaders of our nation, and on all who exercise rightful authority in our community. Instruct them out of your law, that they may administer all affairs of state in justice and equity. May peace and security, happiness and prosperity, right and freedom forever abide among us. Unlike the inhabitants of our country of all backgrounds and creeds, into a bond of true kinship, to banish hatred and bigotry, and to safeguard our ideals and institutions of freedom. May this land, under your providence, be an influence of good throughout the world, uniting all people in peace and freedom and helping to fulfill the vision of your prophets. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they war anymore. For all people, both great and small, shall know the Lord. Amen.
Yes, indeed. That was the appropriate Beit Shuva response. Fuck yeah. I'm going to invite Drew and Hannah to come back up and open the and carry the Torah back into the ark.
Tzayim hilamach hazikim ba v'tomerecha meushar. Tzayim hilamach hazikim ba v'tomerecha meushar. Drachecha drachenam v'chol netivotecha shalom. Drachecha drachenam v'chol netivotecha shalom. Amen.
Cantor, do you know what day it is today?
I believe it's the second day of Rosh Hashanah.
That's the easy answer.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
This is the day that the Lord has made. It's a good answer. Hayom harat ha'olam. For those who didn't get it in Hebrew, today is the world that the day that the world was birthed and is birthed. We talk about Rosh Hashanah because it is a moment of renewal. I think about when I witnessed my wife give birth to our two kids. There was everything that led up before that moment. It was mystery, fear, wonder. I had no idea what was coming. Is it a boy? Is it a girl? Are they healthy? What's this person gonna be like? And then that child is there, and it's a whole new world. In a lot of ways, the imagery of Rosh Hashanah is giving birth to a new world, to a new version of ourselves, to a version that everything that happened chronologically before today, it almost doesn't matter. Because the moment now is new. The moment now is for us to recreate our future. Hayom harat ha'olam. This is the day that the world is being birthed. And sometimes, in that rebirth, there's loss. So we're going to hear some songs, one by Leonard Cohen, Who by Fire, but also the prayers of the Unatana Tokef talk about loss and destruction. Some of us will be here next year. Some of us might not. And so we honor that birth, that creation, and the mystery that might fall. We don't know what the future holds, but we can recreate it ourselves. So we're going to sing Who by Fire and the traditional music of the Unatana Tokef. You can pages 6 and 7 in our little sheets.
Solitude, who this mirror? Who by his lady's command? Who by his own hand? Who in mortal chains? Who in power? And who shall I say is
You guys are good. And this is the line, right? On Rosh Hashanah yikatevun, on Rosh Hashanah it is written, uv'yom tzom kippur yechatemun. And on Yom Kippur, on the fast of Yom Kippur, it is sealed. We still have chance to change our fate, to dictate our own destiny. And it requires tshuva, tefillah, and tzedakah. Doing tshuva, making amends, doing right, prayer, and giving of tzedakah.
Rosh Hashanah yikatevun yikatevun uveyom tzom kippur yechatemun yechatemun Rosh Hashanah yikatevun yikatevun uveyom tzom kippur yechatemun yechatemun Ashana ikatevun uveyom tzom kippur yichatemun kama kama yavoron Vechama Ibarehu Brosh Hashanah Yikatevun Yikatevun Uveyom Tzom Kippur Yechatemun Yechatemun Brosh Hashanah Yikatevun yechatevun uveyom tzom kippur yechatemun yechatemun mi yihye umi yamud mi yivekitso umi umi lo Mi v'mayim, mi v'cheref, umi v'chaya, mi v'ra'av, umi v'tzama, mi v'ash, umi v'magefa, mi v'chanika, umi Brosh Hashanah yikatevun yikatevun uveyom tzom kippur yechatemun yechatemun Brosh Hashanah yikatevun yechatevun uveyom tzom kippur yechatemun
serenity, and who is confused? And tshuva and prayer and tzedakah annul the severity of the decree. It's amazing to me that song, that liturgical poem is dark. Who's going to live? Who's going to die? And the tune is pretty happy, right? You want to dance a little bit. You're clapping around. And maybe that's a symbol of life, right? Despite the chaos, despite the brokenness, despite what might be, how do we choose happiness? How do we choose life? How do we choose to dance? So I want to invite Alex M. to come up for a kavanot on malchiot, on kingship.
Thank you. Shana tova. My name is Alex, and I'm an addict and grateful member of this community. The Great Elenu states that it is our obligation to praise the God of everything, to give greatness to the author of creation. God has made us unique among peoples and has placed us uniquely among the tribes of this earth. Our heritage is set apart from theirs and our destiny unique. We bend our knees and prostrate ourselves and give thanks before the sovereign of the sovereigns of sovereigns, the Holy Blessed One. Now, 10 months ago, I stumbled through the doors of 8831 Venice Boulevard, broken mentally and bankrupt spiritually. Religion of any kind had never been a factor in my life. And looking back, the subconscious yearning to fill that God-sized hole absolutely played a major role in my drug and alcohol afflictions. A misguided attempt to elevate my level of consciousness, if you will. Now as I speak to you, I do not go a day without giving praise and thanks to God. For through his divine intervention, I was fortunate enough to land here at Beit Teshuvah and have been given an opportunity at a second chance. Without God's grace, I wouldn't be here speaking to you today, and that's an absolute truth. Now, yesterday was the first time I tried prostrating myself during the Great Elenu, or any prayer for that matter. The experience went right past my brain and hit me somewhere far more profound. We consciously prayed with our bodies, and in that moment, when my head hit the ground, I was completely present. I felt connected to the source, to the essence. An overwhelming sense of humility in the presence of something greater than myself, and a profuse feeling of coming home washed over me. I felt closer to God than I have ever felt before in my life. And some part of me was still on the ground long after we had risen and moved on. It was as if God's sovereignty, his all-encompassing power, was making itself felt through all of our minds, our hearts, and our bodies. Now, the Great Elenu states that God has made us unique among peoples and has placed us uniquely among the tribes of the earth. And it's true. Regardless of our backgrounds, each and every one of us are members of this unique Beit Teshuvah tribe. We all have a set of talents, experiences, and blessings that are uniquely our own. Our task, one that comes with time and work, is to figure out how we use those tools that have been bestowed upon us. Recover your passion, discover your purpose. That is how we give greatness to the author of creation. We are all here for a reason, and at this moment, we're exactly where we need to be. Love you all. Thank you.
Beautiful, Alex. So this is an opportunity to practice exactly what Alex just talked about, to pray with our bodies. Posture conveys. And so in a moment, we're all going to rise, and we invite you to fully prostrate on the floor. To have a moment of powerlessness, to have a moment of complete surrender and devotion, to spread out, find your space, and more importantly, we get up afterwards. After that moment of powerlessness, we exercise our power of action and choice and how we lift each other up. whether ourselves or maybe you need to lean over to somebody else and help them up. So I invite everybody to stand, to bow, and then to get up and do this holy work. The great Aleinu.
Aleinu l'shabeach l'adon hakol l'atet gedol aleotze bereshit shelo asanu kegoye haratzot velo samanu kemishpechot ha'adama shelo sam chelkenu kahem vegor aleinu kechot
get to do that on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. There's a little envy I have for Islam on that. Do that five times a day. Pretty powerful. I want to introduce Justin H. to come up and give us a kavanah on Zichronot, remembrance. Wow. Somebody's well-liked.
Shana Tova. My name is Justin. I'm a grateful resident of this community. And let me flip this. Okay, so I have Zikaronot. Nice. And I'm going to read it first. It's, you remember that all has transpired since the beginning of time. Before you, all the secrets, all the hidden things, the ages are revealed. For you, there is no forgetfulness. From you, nothing is concealed. Our God and God of our ancestors, remember us with blessing, with deliverance, and with compassion. Remember the covenant you made with Abraham, our father, on Mount Moriah. Fulfill for us, Adonai, our God, the word which you promised us in your Torah. Through your servant Moses, from the mouth of your glory, as it is said, and I will remember for them the covenant with their ancestors whom I brought out of the land of Egypt in the sight of nations to be their God. I am Adonai, for the one who remembers all forgotten things from eternity is you. And there is no forgetfulness before the throne of your glory. Remember the binding of Isaac today on behalf of his descendants with compassion. Blessed are you, Adonai, who remembers the covenant. So when I see this prayer and I think of the covenant it references, I see that like Abraham, I had a child, not an actual child. I had something that represented who I wanted you to think I am. It represented the work I had put in, my pride, and what I thought was my legacy. I defined myself by it, and the thing that it was the thing that I could point to and say, look what I have created. And much like Abraham, I was forced to give it up. I was forced to surrender. And in my case, I'm not talking about addiction. although I was forced to give that up as well. I'm talking about the things that my ego defined itself by: job, marriage, entitlement, old ideas, and these had become masks that I had worn to make me feel safe. The way that I separated from you, and it took me a long time to be willing or even see that there was something beyond the loss I felt of having to give those things up. In fighting against what my Creator wanted for me, I cursed my own life by clinging to things that in essence were blocking my soul from connecting to joy with others. I used to see God as someone who cursed me at not being good enough or stripped me so that I could follow his path. It's no wonder why I projected that core ideal onto others and blamed them. So calamity has a way of kind of bringing things into focus, and it was the inertia that I needed to surrender what I felt I needed for the world to accept me. Once I laid bare that sacrifice, I started to experience the fulfillment of covenant. Michael Sacks appeared and brought scrutiny. Rabbi Mikhail brought vigilance and introspection, and Rabbi Joseph brought a disarming way to deconstruct walls I had built. Yehuda brought understanding, but most of all, the resonance brought brotherhood and acceptance. And I have begun to see that my Creator differently through that. I know he doesn't hand out curses. Rather, I believe he just wants me to experience love and joy in my heart and do the best to shine that back into the world. Today, I feel moved in a way that I haven't experienced before this. I'm getting more in tune with the things that I need to surrender so I can feel closer to you and feel love. In my heart, I am able to feel and access that now on a more regular basis, and that's been a great joy. I mean, in the physical world, horrible things happen to good people all the time. I don't believe that my Creator has a hand in that. I do believe in a loving energy that lies beneath physicality, that despite outside circumstances gives everyone the opportunity to experience joy and divinity. The hard part for me is in continually searching to access it. But luckily, I have the support of people around me and the love that a lot of great people have poured into me to access that anytime I choose. And I'm very grateful for that today. Thank you.
Keep on accessing that, Justin. Keep on moving from being closed to open. That's the gift. That's the work. Zichron note.
Ata zocher maseh olam ufoker ko yitzore Nefanecha niglu kot alamot ve'amon nisdarot shemi bereshit ki hen shechicha lifnei chisech evodecha ve'nistor mineged enecha. Eloheinu ve'lohei avoteinu Zocherenu ve'zichron tov lefanecha Ufokteinu bekudot Yeshua Ve'rachamim Shenishbata Lavaraham Avinu Behar Amoria. Vekayem lanu Adonai Eloheinu et hadavar shemi hevtachtano betoratecha oyadem Moshe avdecha mipichevodecha kamo. Asher hatzidot hatzeti otam me'eretz Mitzrayim le'negoyim le'irot lahem le'lohim ani Adonai ki zocher kol hanishkochot atah me'olam ve'en shechicha lifnei chisevodecha ve'akedat Yitzchak lezarayom berachamim tizkor baruch atah Adonai
for Cancer Nate right now. That is not easy, and let me tell you, I am so glad that wasn't me having to read that and sing that.
That's a hard one.
It was a hard one. And likewise, Tony, you are amazing job on piano, and Laura as well. So for the Musaf service on Rosh Hashanah, there's always three parts. We heard Malchiyot, kingship. We heard remembrances, zichronot. And lastly, it's shofarot, the soundings of the shofar. So I want to invite John B. to give a kavana on shofarot.
Hi, everyone. My name is John, and I'm a grateful resident of this community.
Hi, John.
I was asked to speak today on the blessing of the shofar, and it reads, "Blessed are you, sovereign of the universe, who has made us holy with commandments and who has commanded us to hear the sound of the shofar. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, sovereign of the universe, who has granted us life and has sustained us and has brought us to this time." In this prayer, we recognize the divinity God has given to us by providing us with commandments. For me, these serve as a guide on how to live, and one of those commandments is listening to the shofar. At first, it was difficult for me to understand why listening to the shofar is a mitzvah. It has been used to signal an event or make an important announcement, but for it to be a commandment, it must have a higher purpose. For me, that higher purpose is a reminder to be present in my life. Most of my life, I was consumed with constantly trying to anticipate the future or living in regret by dwelling on the past. When I first got here, I was so crippled with anxiety, it was nearly impossible for me to leave my quarantine room. Marissa and Riley had to come talk to me several times to help put my mind at ease. I skipped all my one-on-one sessions because I was scared of being judged or what they might think of me if they knew my past. I would worry about everything imaginable, money, housing, a job, school, family. But when I finally started going to my spiritual advisor, Emma had taught me the value of being present. For me, hearing the sound of the shofar blows away any of my wandering thoughts and calls me to attention. It forces me to pay attention to this exact moment. If I'm not reminded to stop and experience what's happening in my life right now, at this time, I'm going to miss out on everything that's important. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, John. Soak that up, John. Soak it up. Okay. So in a moment, we are going to hear the sounds of the shofar. I'm going to invite Noam to come up to blow our shofar. And like John, that's right. Like John said, we are commanded to hear the sound of the shofar. It's, in fact, if the shofar was stolen, and we hear the sounds of the shofar, we fulfilled our obligation to hear. And I was, how could that be? If it's a stolen shofar, isn't that one of the Ten Commandments? Don't steal. How are we going to fulfill our obligation on a stolen shofar? But just like John said, the shofar blasts are a call to wake up, to be present. You have the alarm clock that somebody takes and wakes us up and forces us to be present. So who's ready to wake up? Yes. What? Yes. I can't hear you. Yes. Who's ready to come alive? Yes. All right, so everybody, I invite everybody to rise. I'm gonna read the blessings of the shofar. And then I'll read them out to Noam to blow. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher kidshanu b'mitzvotav etzivanu Lishmoa kol shofar Tekia. Shvarim trua nine after nine Tekia Tekia Shvarim trua Tekia Tekia Shvarim trua Tekia, Tekia, Shvarim, Tekia, Tekia, Shvarim. Tekia, Tekia, Shvarim, Tekia, Tekia. Trua, Tekia, Tekia, Trua, Tekia, Tekia. Trua. Tekia gedola. Yeah. Way to go, Noam. So we're going to close with Avinu Malkeinu. And while Cantor Nate's coming up here, a couple of years ago, Rabbi Mark pulled me aside and he says, what's Avinu Malkeinu mean to you? It means our father, our king. Well, what does it mean that our father is the king? And I said some stupid answer that he's like, yeah, you were really fucked up, huh? And he said, it means we're royalty. Our father, our king, it means we belong in the palace. It means that we are children of God and we deserve the best. Do we treat ourselves as if we belong in the palace? Do we treat ourselves with the utmost dignity that we are princes and princesses? Avinu Malkeinu is here to remind us that this next year, that's the task.
Avinu Malkeinu, Chaneinu Vaneinu, Avinu Malkeinu, Chaneinu Vaneinu, Ki ein banu maasim, Aseh imanu, Tzedakah v'chesed, Aseh imanu, Tzedakah v'chesed, Ve'oshienu, Aseh imanu, Tzedakah v'chesed, Aseh imanu, Tzedakah Deoshienu, Avinu Malkeinu, Chaneinu Vaneinu, Avinu Malkeinu, Chaneinu Vaneinu, Ki ein banu maasim, Aseh imanu, Tzedakah v'chesed, Aseh imanu, Tzedakah v'chesed, Deoshienu. Aseh imanu, tzedakah v'chesed. Aseh imanu, tzedakah v'chesed, ve'oshienu. Avinu Malkeinu, chaneinu vaneinu. Avinu Malkeinu, chaneinu vaneinu, ki ein banu maasim.
And so we close with Mourner's Kaddish. We close with those who are no longer with us. I'm going to read the names of those who were mourning for this year. David Amdur, Paul Applebaum, Shelley Balloon, Joshua Bloom, William Cohen, Stephanie Coleman, Melissa Gallagher, Ryan Copald, Ned Lerman, Sylvia Macta, Danielle Molina, Ari Osteen, Amy Palubicki, Medina Perez, Stephen Pollock, Ida Portillo, Janice Rothschild, Philip Sakertoff, Mark Schullen, John Sklut, Jeff Tamayo, Al Unger, Zach Woolman, Steve Zimmer. I invite those on Zoom as well to share the names of those you are holding in your heart and in your mind, whether on Zoom or unmuted. And for those here in our community, if there's anybody that you are mourning, I invite you to please rise. And just as it has become custom in our Beit Shuva community, nobody grieves alone. So if there's somebody standing alone, please go stand, put your arm around them as we say Kaddish. Actually, let me say the names too, remembering. Anybody else on Zoom as well? Names are in the chat, I hope. The words for the Kaddish can be found on page 13 of our booklet. Yitgadal v'yitgadash shamei rabah. Be'alma divarach irute ve'amlich malchute. Bechayechon uv'yomechon uv'chaye dechol beit Yisrael. Ba'agala uv'izman kariv v'imru. Amen. Yehe shmei rabah mevarach le'alam le'olme olmaya. Yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitba'ar v'yitromam v'yitnase. V'yitadar v'yitale v'yitalal shmei dekudsha brichu. Le'ela u'le'ela min kol birchata v'shirata. Tush b'chata v'nechemata da'amiran be'alma v'imru. Amen. Yehe shlama rabba min shemaya. V'chaim aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael v'imru. Amen. Ose shalom b'imramav. Hu ya'ase shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael ve'al kol yoshvei tevel v'imru. Amen. May those who have passed be remembered for a blessing. Let us say amen. All right. Very brief announcements. We are doing Tashlich at a park, Sid Kronenthal Park, just around the corner. It's about a 15-minute walk from Beit Shuva. We're getting ready. The residents get ready here, 3:30, to go for the walk. It's a ritual where we cast off our sins. It's a very visceral way of confessing and then letting go with this ritual by throwing these rocks or bread into a body of water. So we're going to go do that. Be ready by 3:30. Community, please join us at 4 o'clock at Sid Kronenthal Park. The only other announcement is September 13th, Monday, September 13th at 4 p.m., it's going to be a virtual programming that Beit Shuva, along with the Elaine Breslow Institute, partnered with the Blue Dove Foundation, is going to be doing a program on the High Holidays and an addiction, and it's a really interesting partnership. We're going to have a resident story, plus Doug Rosen and myself share some wisdom as well, so there'll be information passed out on the Shmata and everything about that partnership with Blue Dove. Other than that, Yom Kippur is 9 days away. Anything else I should come back virtually in person? And Tim's got another announcement. Dinner is at 6 p.m. So what's for dinner, Tim? It's a surprise. Started thinking about food. I wanted to know. Want to know if I wanted to come. All right, we're going to finish off with Kiddush and Motzi Cantor. Hold on 1 second. Give it up another time for Cantor Nate. And Tony on keys. Laura Bagish.
Yeah, Laura.
Give it up for our tech crew, Mike C., Jesse, Mickey, Brandon, Max. Our Torah readers, Jana and Cynthia, all of our amazing, amazing speakers, Chaya and Jillian, and the many, many other our rabbinic partners, Chaplain Adam Siegel, Rabbi Carey, and Rabbi Miriam.
And Rabbi Joseph.
Oh, and I'll take a little credit as well. Thank you, Nate. We're going to end with Kiddush and Motzi, and really thank you for this incredible gift of this community to be able to spend the Rosh Hashanah together. No other place I'd rather be.
Everyone, please rise. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei peri hagafen. We got this is challah.
So we're doing well today.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen.
May it be a sweet and good new year. Shana tova u'metukah.